Good evening. Welcome to the League of Women Voters of Berks County's monthly program. My name is Jennifer Hanf, and I am a member of the League of Women Voters of Berks County. This evening, we are going to be discussing the federal courts, judges, and our judicial system to gain a deeper understanding of why courts matter. Our courts are often referred to as the last line of defense in our democracy, and tonight, we hope to understand this more deeply. I'd like to introduce you to Ms. Kadida Kenner, a Westchester, Pennsylvania native and Temple University graduate. Kadida Kenner was most recently a writer, a producer, and director for college sports television programming in Charlotte, North Carolina. Energized by the 2016 elections, she decided to take a hiatus from TV production and return to campaign work as a field and digital organizer for the North Carolina Democratic Party's coordinated campaign. Following elections, Kadida moved back to Pennsylvania and currently lives in Harrisburg while she's working as a campaign manager for Why Courts Matter, Pennsylvania, a nonpartisan coalition of organizations and advocates working to ensure our federal courts are filled with diverse, independent, well-qualified mainstream jurists who are dedicated to fairness and impartiality and keeping with the core constitutional values of our country. The organization Why Courts Matter is nonpartisan, nonprofit, and it's a coalition of more than 40 organizational partners representing tens of thousands of Pennsylvanians working together to educate the public about the importance of filling federal court vacancies with fair and independent judges. The federal courts, from the district courts up onto the Supreme Court, often play an even bigger role on what kind of country we live in than elected representatives or the executive branch. And so we hope that the courts will be the first and not the last line of defense. Our courts, from direct challenges to policies like the Muslim ban, to protecting the rights of workers, women, people of color, persons with disabilities, LGBT communities, and more. The future of the federal judiciary is essential. And with that, I'd like to encourage, we're going to start asking questions, and I would like to encourage home viewers to hear, we'd like to hear from you. So please call in with questions that can be answered by our guest, Kadida. And oh, and our number to call is 610-378-0426. I'm going to start with a question that maybe can set the stage. Kadida, why do we need to learn more about our federal judicial court system?
So if we want to go back a little bit and go back to like civics when we were in high school, mm-hmm. we learned about federalism and we learned about the separation of powers and our three branches of government. Well, our federal court system, one of those, you know, separations of powers, is so important, especially in times like this, when we believe that, we have a federal judiciary crisis right now. There is a crisis going on in the federal judiciary. And so I think it's so important that we talk about the federal courts and people get an understanding. We learned about them in 10th grade or 11th grade, and we kind of stepped away from that. And I think this election mm-hmm. has energized some folks to learn more about mm-hmm. the federal courts. So I would love to be able to explain to folks tonight, you know, more about the court system, what the process is like of our federal courts, how we nominate, how we confirm federal judges who sit on our courts here in this country for a lifetime.
I think that would be very helpful to us in Berks County. Thank you very much.
So we're going to get right into it?
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. Do you want to start with the
sure.
the first topic, the blue slips?
Well, we'll get to the blue slips.
Okay,
yeah.
I'll let you get started.
So let's talk about the process
okay.
of how we get a federal judge, how a federal judge becomes a federal judge. So here in Pennsylvania, things have been pretty good when it comes to our senator, Senator Casey and Toomey, working together to fill our benches with qualified nominees. They've had success these last 6 years in doing that, and so we're hoping that trend continues. So how do we get a federal judge? Here in Pennsylvania, we sit on the Third Circuit Court of Appeals. It's jurisdiction for New Jersey, Delaware, Pennsylvania, and the U.S. Virgin Islands. And so we have some vacancies that we need to fill, but how do we get to that point? So we'll have committees. Toomey and Casey will get together. They have committees. They have folks they like out in Pittsburgh or in Philadelphia or the central area, you know, of Pennsylvania. And they'll have these potential nominees. They're professors. They are assistant U.S. attorneys. They are current judges. And so they'll, you know, come up with some names, and they'll say, I like this person. They'll take this person's name to the President of the United States, at which point the President will actually then nominate this individual officially. So this has happened in the past, you know, few months. We had a nomination of Stefanos Bibas. He was a University of Pennsylvania law professor, criminal law. He was nominated by Donald Trump to be a Third Circuit Court of Appeal judge. He then went from there to the Senate Judiciary Committee hearing, where Chuck Grassley and everyone there on the committee voted him out of the committee and into a full Senate vote. Mm-hmm. And at that point, our U.S. senators, all of them, vote on these nominees. No matter what state these individuals will sit, every U.S. senator votes for this nominee. He was confirmed pretty much on a party ticket, party line, with the exception of Manchin in West Virginia, Senator Manchin. Mm-hmm. It was a party line vote for Stefanos Bibas in Pennsylvania. And then he was confirmed. And so now he sits on our Third Circuit Court of Appeals, which is in Philadelphia. But there's going back a little bit, you know, the how that all comes about. So we talk about Toomey and Casey having committees and then recommending someone to the President to nominate. That's typically how it goes. But what we're finding right now in this current climate is that it's really not going that way. It's not Senator Casey and Toomey talking about certain individuals and then throwing them up into the President to then go ahead and nominate officially. What we're seeing right now is that Casey really is not having his input. He's not being able to provide his constitutional role of advice and consent and actually have some say. A lot of these nominees are coming from the Federalist Society and the Heritage Foundation. They're pretty much outsourcing our picks, which has turned this into a political process more than should be.
I have to back up and ask you, now how on earth would you know during that process if that judge would be qualified?
Yeah.
That, I wonder.
Yeah.
So, I didn't hear anything about that.
Exactly, yeah. So what typically happens, and I say what typically because things aren't normal at this time. Things aren't going the way they usually go. How they've gone for hundreds of years, really. And so if we want to, you know, take a step back to see if someone's qualified, that usually happens during the conversations between senators.
Right.
You know, and then they'll have this blue slip that we talked about. And I would love to, I can throw that up on the screen.
Sure, you can.
Yeah.
Yep.
Give me one second. We'll grab this here and I'll throw that up. There we go. We're ready for that. All right. So this is the blue slip. And if we know anything about federal government, it's that the Senate is all about tradition. The blue slip is a tradition. It's not a rule. It's not a law. It's 100 years old this year. And the blue slip is a tradition that allows for our home state senators, for Bob Casey and for Pat Toomey, to have some kind of advice and consent when it comes to judges that would sit on a bench in their state. So this has been going on for 100 years. Once Casey and Toomey both say, you know what, I do. I like this nominee. I think they're going to make, even if they don't agree with them politically on issues or ideology, they don't agree, they can still turn in a blue slip for this person with signals of hearing. So at this point, once a blue slip has been turned in by both senators, that signals a hearing. And then the Senate Judiciary Committee will then move forward with a hearing.
Okay.
So that's how it has worked in the past. Mm-hmm. When we talked about Stefanos Bibas earlier, Senator Casey was unable to turn in his blue slip immediately because he was waiting for the American Bar Association rating.
Uh-huh.
And that's great. We could take that off. Yeah, we were waiting for the American Bar Association rating. He was also waiting to read thousands of pages of Bibas's work. He is a prolific blogger and writer. He had lots to say, mm-hmm. and so Casey wanted to read all that before he turned in his blue slip.
Get a little background
on him, mm-hmm. and also to find out that he was a well-qualified nominee from the American Bar Association.
Did he have much experience?
He had experience in trying cases. Mm-hmm. He did. A very great professor at University of Pennsylvania. There were some things that came up, you know, during the hearings that were of concern and in his writings, things that Bibas had said in the past about how he felt about drug addiction, that maybe he said that maybe it's not a disease. It's something that someone can overcome. Mm-hmm. He also had said in the past that maybe those who were imprisoned should be conscribed to the military. These are some of the concerns that we had at Why Courts Matter with the Bibas nomination. So that's pretty much how.
So you have a worry that, somebody like that might become a very activist kind of a judge, and rather than following the law, would be kind of interpreting the law.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You know, when we talk about the federal courts, you know, we all are, you know, are advocating for courts that are going to be fair. Mm-hmm. And diverse. And when we say diverse, it doesn't just mean ethnically or racially diverse, but diverse in profession as well. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so it's so important that, you know, when we talk about characteristics of a good judge, it's someone that can have perspective, you mm-hmm. know, that they can understand the working man. You
right.
know, we need a judge that can understand the working man. Maybe they lived paycheck to paycheck at some mm-hmm. point in their life, mm-hmm. or they grew up in poverty and know what it's like to struggle. Mm-hmm. Because when you are in your, you know, when you have your day in court, you want someone that's going to really understand you.
Right.
You know.
Right.
And judge on that.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Well, I have a question then. I would like to know why. Would you consider us being in a judicial crisis at this moment? I've heard this yeah. bandied around a lot, and I sure would like you to yeah. kind of expound upon that a little bit.
Yeah. We are in a federal judiciary crisis at the moment. There are 140 vacancies okay. on the federal courts. 140. And these are lifetime appointments. So these mm-hmm. aren't folks that are just going to be here sitting on a federal bench, you know, for 4 years or 8 years. They're there for a lifetime. And we have so many openings on our federal courts due to the obstruction in the last 2 years of President Obama's presidency. Lots of obstruction in those last 2 years, which has created this judicial crisis.
Does that tend to hold up court cases?
If
there are a lack of openings, vacancies?
It can. Mm-hmm. It can stop the cases that are being heard. There's tens of thousands of cases heard in federal courts every year. Mm-hmm. You know, not every case is going to hit the Supreme Court. Mm-hmm. They're going to hit these lower courts. They're going to hit the district courts and the Circuit Court of Appeals. And so it's so important that these are all filled with qualified jurists who are going to try these cases in a timely manner and make sure that we all get the justice that we need when it's our day in court.
I want to reiterate to the viewers that please call in. The number is 610-378-0426. This is the League of Women Voters, and our program tonight is Why Courts Matter with Kadida Kenner. Thank you very much. Mm-hmm. I'm going to ask another question. Who are the judges being appointed by the present administration? Now, yeah. I'm talking yeah. On the federal level.
Yeah. So this is part of the judicial crisis.
Okay.
Is that we're having nominees being put forward who are backed by the Federalist Society and the Heritage okay. Foundation, who have been deemed to be not qualified by the American Bar Association. The American Bar Association has been reviewing potential nominees since 1989. And since 1989, only four nominees have received unanimous non-qualified ratings. Currently, Donald Trump owns two of those four within his first year of his presidency. That's history being made right there. And so that's a concern, that these nominees are not qualified for this position. This is a lifetime position. We had spoke earlier about Brett Talley.
Right. I wanted to maybe talk yeah. about some of the problems with qualification. Mm-hmm. What are the things that maybe are red flags?
Yeah. Well, you know, let's talk about nominee Brett Talley
okay.
out of Alabama right now. He's a young man, 36, 37 years okay. old. He has never tried a federal case in his life. And he's being considered for the federal bench for a lifetime appointment in Alabama. This is an example of someone mm-hmm. who's not qualified mm-hmm. to
right,
sit on a federal
right,
bench.
Right. So you have very little experience. You basically are starting at square one, fresh out of school almost.
Yeah. And yep. and the issue with yes. that, too, is that it seems that these are rubber stamp picks. Mm-hmm. If you go and think about the history of Talley is actually his wife. Works in the White House. Mm-hmm. So you have to, you know,
and
think
she's
yourself,
a lawyer. She,
yeah,
am I right?
She's a lawyer.
Yes.
And so
that's
you have
a potential conflict of
interest. It's a conflict of interest.
I can see that.
Exactly.
Now, is it because there's a lack of qualified judges, that other judges that might be considered?
Yeah.
Or do we?
I can't say that it's a lack of judges. Mm-hmm. I think that there are very qualified jurists out there that could potentially fill these federal benches. Mm-hmm. It just seems that the nominees that are coming across the desk at this moment, are, it's like cronyism to a point where we're getting these judges who are friends with the White House and now all of a sudden, or lawyers who are friends with the White House and now all of a sudden are becoming federal judges for a lifetime.
Right. So what we want to do is try to open the playing field, which leads me to another question that I wanted to talk about, was the diversity of the court. Mm-hmm. By that I mean the composition of it in terms of people of color, minorities, and women on courts. Maybe you can talk a little bit about that, about the history of that, about how we're moving.
Yeah. You know, right now women make up 50% of law schools. Mm-hmm. Yet, we are lacking when it comes to women being on the federal courts. It's so important to have a perspective of a woman on a federal court. And studies have proven that when there is a woman on a panel, the male judges pay more attention to cases, particularly cases that involve civil rights. And so that's why it's so important that we have women on the courts. You know, to give you a little context about how it went in Obama's presidency, he nominated or confirmed 42% of the judges that he put forward were women. Mm-hmm. 42%. Currently in this administration, it's floating around 20%. Trump has confirmed 20% women.
President Trump, yeah.
But what's startling to us right now is that, if you know, we want to talk about diversity. 92% are white. Mm-hmm. Are judges, mm-hmm. white judges, and so, you know,
that's not really representative.
It's not representative of the United
States
at all.
And I think that it also may have some other implications in terms of how people perceive the court too.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
I know that we have a home viewer. Maybe we should break a little bit and find out what the question is. Hello, would you like to ask us a question?
Well, good evening, ladies. How are you?
Hello.
I just had a couple of general questions. The League of Women Voters, I know that you appear on television like every 2 to 4 years. Other than that, we don't see you around. Are you a nonpartisan group, or do you have leanings toward the Democrat Party or the Republican?
That's a very good question. And we are nonpartisan. One of the things that we feel very strongly about is voter rights and to encourage voting. So that you may not see us out and about, but we are in schools, we're in universities, and lots of places where we can hold voting events. We are involved in candidates' forums, giving Republicans and Democrats candidates, all of them, a chance to talk about their candidacy and their goals. Yes, we are nonpartisan, but we do get involved with specific issues that we feel are of concern to the general public, and this is one of them. Just discussing and learning about how courts affect our lives is something that we wanted to bring to the public. And to be honest with you, we actually have a program once a month. So it's on BCTV every month. So I urge you to check back in at 8 o'clock on on Tuesdays and hear us out. Thank you for calling.
I'm not done.
Oh, okay, great.
Don't give me the brush off.
Okay.
Yeah, and I do know that you promote voting and you have your forms for the candidates, and that is very worthwhile. But I think when it comes to where you have an issue that you feel strongly about, that's when you can kind of dip left or right. But anyhow, I don't want to belabor that point. To our guest tonight, I only tuned in about 10 minutes ago. Who does your guest represent?
Okay.
What group?
Okay. Yes, I am with Why Courts Matter Pennsylvania. We are a nonpartisan, nonprofit organization.
So you're nonpartisan too?
We are a nonpartisan organization, yes, sir.
Okay, and all right. And you believe that?
We believe that because we believe that our federal courts should be filled with nominees who are mainstream, who are diverse, who are qualified, and who are fair. And so,
I think
that
anyone who is politically active, if they were asked the same question, if they were ultra-right or ultra-left, would go, no, 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 we're nonpartisan, because they believe it so fervently that they actually do believe that they're nonpartisan. And then one final comment. The ABA is often cited for falling one way or the other regarding judges, whether it's locally or statewide or nationally. The ABA, likewise, don't they have an agenda? And doesn't their agenda skew left more than right?
That's a really good question.
It's a good question, but, you know, I have to go back to the fact that we've been dealing with ABA ratings since 1989.
And I know that. But the AMA, they have a political agenda. The PSCA or the NEA, they all have political agendas, just like the NRA. Mm-hmm. Has a political agenda.
You know, I guess it is, in a way, how you define political, because political has a lot to do with people, and I think we do get very passionate about issues, all of us, whether you're in education or whether you're in a medical field, or, you know, if you're looking at the courts and judicial, your concern is judicial.
I agree with you.
I welcome your question, and I thank you very much. So.
Okay. Well, very good. I just wanted to ask this question. Thank you, ladies.
Thank you very much
for calling.
Very nice show.
Okay. All right. So, let's see. We were talking about women, and we were talking about minorities, mm-hmm. and that was a concern that we have. It's a concern to create a kind of equity and mm-hmm. and it's a balance, really, mm-hmm. that I think.
Yeah, I'm going to show this if we can. Yeah,
great. Yeah,
there's something we would love to show.
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, that's an excellent.
If we can talk about this, it's a nice little graphic here. This is actually a tweet from the Legal Defense Fund of the NAACP, and it discusses the trend. You know, the disturbing trend that we're having right now mm-hmm. when it comes to nominees of color.
Yes.
So if the viewers at home can take a look at this, and this is a perfect example of why there are so many vacancies. Number one, because of the obstruction in the last 2 years. And it's also to talk about the fact that we are lacking judicial nominees right now mm-hmm. that are diverse. Mm-hmm. And it's important that our federal judges match what, you know, what's going on in the nation. Mm-hmm. If someone wants to believe that they're receiving full justice, it's kind of nice to see mm-hmm. someone who kind of looks like you behind a bench sometimes.
It also
too.
Gives you a life experience. You were talking a little bit about the life experience
exactly.
of a professional
exactly.
person in, you know, in the position of being a judge, yeah. I think it does help. And when you have diverse backgrounds, it mm-hmm. also helps to build a balance, I think, that yeah. reflects our society.
Exactly. And for the viewers at home, I want them to see a little something here yeah. on this graphic. And if you look at the bottom row, these were all the nominees that President Obama put forward in his last 2 years in office. And all of these folks were qualified. They all had ratings from the ABA. They would all make good judges, yet the home state senators in their states did not turn in blue slips for them. Mm-hmm. It was part of the obstruction that Senator Mitch McConnell had discussed, that they were going to hold up this process and wait for the next administration to take over. And so the bottom left there is a gentleman named Judge Cologne out of Alabama. He would have been the first African-American federal judge in Alabama. In more than 170 years, that state has never had an African-American federal judge. He was replaced by someone, Newsom, who obviously is not African-American. And so it's important that, you know, that we can get some diversity on this federal mm-hmm. bench.
And it's not a matter of qualifications, because all of these people that you're talking about are qualified.
Yeah.
So if you can pass muster on that, and then you're looking for a diversity and balance.
Yeah. And just to point out one more there, that bottom row, the third to the left, is Rebecca Haywood. She's the assistant U.S. attorney out of Pittsburgh. She's been in that position for 13 years, eminently qualified to be a federal judge. She was passed over. Senator Toomey would not turn in a blue slip for Rebecca Haywood, and so her nomination sat there. And she's currently still the assistant U.S. attorney in Pittsburgh. She was replaced by Stefanos Bibas, mm-hmm. who we had talked about earlier, right above her.
Yeah.
Who is the criminal law professor who ended up getting the job of Third Circuit Court of Appeals judge. We do have one more vacancy in the Third Circuit Court of Appeals in Pennsylvania, so that's still something we could talk about.
Okay, well, that's good. And I see we have another home viewer. Welcome. Can you give us your question?
Sure.
Okay.
My question is concerns the recent judge election, Nevis, Tina Boyd and Ben Nevis.
Nevis. That is a local elected judge position. It's a county position. It's the Court of Common Pleas.
Right. Did gerrymandering affect that, do you think?
I personally don't think so, but...
Does gerrymandering affect that election?
It's a countywide election.
Yeah, that's a for a countywide election.
Yeah, I don't think so. That one is, it's a local election. What we're talking about and concentrating tonight are the federal appointments, but those local judge are also important because that's where they gradually rise to the ranks until they do reach a federal appointment. So, yes, they're at the beginning of their career. And Ben was the winner, and they both ran a good race, in my opinion.
Very nice. I appreciate it. Yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. So moving on. Let's see. I want to ask, what are some of the challenges that are facing Pennsylvania federal courts? And we've already talked about a little bit more. Maybe we can get into a little bit more detail about some challenges.
Yeah, we're not really experiencing a judicial emergency, per se, in Pennsylvania because we're lacking judges. We have a good amount, you know. We're not in emergency stages at all. We do have some judges who have taken senior status. The former First Lady, Marjorie Rendell, who is a Third Circuit Court of Appeal judge. Mm. She is on senior status.
What does that mean? What is senior status?
It means that, you know, these are lifetime appointments, but at some point, people would like to retire, you know.
Okay.
So a senior status meaning she's just taking less of a caseload.
Okay.
Usually it's less than 70% of a typical caseload.
Okay.
And I had a nice little conversation with the judge not too long ago, and she's enjoying the senior status. And, you know, it's just an opportunity to get out on the bench eventually. Mm-hmm. And for the record, Stefanos Bibas officially took her seat.
Okay.
Yeah.
And do you feel that we have enough young people coming forward that we'll be able to balance the age disparities?
Yeah, well, actually, some part of this is kind of concerning when it comes to the age. When you have
young
folks like 36 and 37 who've never tried a case.
That's true.
You know, maybe it's
what
not
about
so
the 40
great to have
and 50
it.
Years old? What about the people that are in the prime of their career?
Yeah. So, yeah, we are right now, what we're seeing in Donald Trump's nominees are these folks are in their 40s.
Mm-hmm.
And so they will sit on the bench for 40 years.
Okay.
You know, no matter how long his presidency lasts, if it's 8 years or less, these folks will be there longer than him. This will be his legacy.
So it's important that they are qualified. It's basically what you're saying. It's important that any judge be qualified because it is a lifetime appointment.
They'll be there for generations.
And I think that kind of really makes its point. Because we have elected officials that are going to be for a period of time and move on, or they can always be challenged. But a federal judge is there for life.
For life.
Okay. Let's see. I'm just thinking, what's been the response that you've been receiving as you've been traveling around the state presenting your program? I know that you have a longer program in which you really educate, and I urge people to come out to one of your events.
Yeah.
But what kind of, can you give us a feeling for the response you've been getting?
So, you know, I am from Pennsylvania, the whole thing here. I was born in Monroeville, out in western Pennsylvania. I grew up in Westchester. I currently reside in Harrisburg, so I've pretty much covered
the state. You've been around the state?
I've been around the state. And I've been traveling this state for almost the last year now. I've been up to Wayne County, Honesdale, Wayne County. I've been all over Pittsburgh and the suburbs and Lehigh Valley and Harrisburg, Central PA. I've been all over, mainly talking to a lot of the grassroots groups that have popped up since the 2016 elections. And they're burning for education and knowledge. And so the reception has been phenomenal. People just want the education because education is power.
Mm-hmm.
So once you explain to them how the federal process of nominating and confirming judges works, they feel, you know, powerful because now they have the education. You know, a lot of times, people know about what's going on with the Supreme Court because that makes the headlines.
Mm-hmm.
But these lower courts, the district courts and the Circuit Court of Appeals, they don't make your mainstream media headlines all the time. And so to get this information to them is crucial.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right. I have a question too, and we can come back to this later, but I think it's so important, is what can we as the average constituent, what can we do to advocate for high quality federal courts? What can we do?
Yeah, you know, I have...
These are appointments, so...
These are appointments, and so you can't... They can't vote on these.
Right, that's right.
So who does vote on these nominees are our U.S. senators. And so it's so important that we can reach out to our U.S. senators, make phone calls, send them emails and faxes, and write letters to the editors, and let them know that you are interested in having these lifetime appointments be filled by individuals who are qualified. And that's, you know, whether or not if it's an AB rating, ABA rating or not, you know, someone who's never tried a case in federal court, maybe it's not their time yet to be a federal judge. Let them get a little more time and position.
I think we even have a graphic for people that might want to be writing their senators. It's easy to get this information online, but we have it for you right now if you want to take a pen and jot this down.
Yes.
These are our two senators. We have two for the state of Pennsylvania, two for every state.
Yeah, so what we advocate for is, you know, folks to call their U.S. senators. They work for us. And people, we know, we voted for them. And so we want to talk to them about making sure that they're putting the best possible nominees in position for our federal courts.
I think it's also really interesting to hear you say that for 6 years, both Casey and Toomey have been working together well for Pennsylvania, and I think that's important to let them know that we appreciated that and that they should keep that up.
Keep that up, It's something that they both like to tout, is the bipartisan relationship when it comes to working together to fill the courts. And so if you're going to make any phone calls, you know, we want to call on Senator Toomey and tell Senator Toomey that he should not be voting yes for nominee Tally. You know, let Tally get some more experience before he comes back to a federal judgeship that's there for a lifetime.
Work it out together. Find out.
And we can find some more qualified nominees. It's not about, you know, are they left or are they right? Are they qualified? That's the big thing. And so, you know, I've written a lot to Senator Toomey over the last few months.
Yes. Do you want to share some of that? I think that might be interesting.
Yeah. And you know, I'm gonna move to that if I can. You know, an example of people who have written prior. I don't have it up here yet, but I reached out to Senator Toomey several times, you know, and I'll go into his office in Harrisburg, or if I'm in Allentown or wherever I am, I'll stop in Senator Toomey's office and I'll leave him a letter to the editor that had been published or, you know, what have you. And I got a return back from Senator Toomey, and this is what he said to me. He said that he believes that the Senate's constitutional role in providing advice and consent for federal judiciary appointments is important, and such nominees deserve careful consideration. He said that he takes his constitutional role providing advice and consent for judicial appointments seriously, and he has supported and will continue to support well-qualified nominees selected by the president. That's what he said to me in a letter back in May of this year. And I'm going to hold him to this.
Absolutely.
He said that he would support well-qualified nominees. I'm okay with that as long as they're well-qualified. Same thing with Senator Casey. We reach out to his office as well. Continue to make sure that he is only going to be voting for nominees who are well-qualified.
I'm curious, too. You've been doing so much work on this over time. And I'm wondering what's been done in the past historically to defend court systems.
Well, actually in Pennsylvania, there's been lots of activism around the federal courts. Why Courts Matter has been in existence in some form or fashion for almost a decade, advocating for the federal courts. Back in 2014, we were fighting the potential nomination of a gentleman named David Porter. He's an attorney out of Pittsburgh, Federal Society president. He used to be Senator Rick Santorum's personal attorney. He was rumored to be a nominee as part of a package that Senator Casey and Toomey had worked out back in 2014. But the White Courts Matter Coalition fought that nomination, potential nomination, because we know how harmful David Porter nomination could be for Pennsylvania.
And why would that be? Why would, what would make him so harmful?
Well, number one, we didn't agree with some of his stances. He's also a very prolific blogger. He is, he was the president of the Federal Society, Pittsburgh chapter, which can bring some very conservative activist opinions, you know, to a federal court And so he's just somebody that we did not want to see sit on a court, in a federal court in Pennsylvania. We actually created an opposition website for David Porter. It's www.davidporterfiles.com. Hmm. And so if anyone at home wants to learn more about
David Porter. I think we all should go and learn a little bit more. Because I was wondering, because I think when I thought about judges, when I was learning about the judicial in school, I kind of believed that that was removed from politics, that the process of becoming a judge and what we want a judge to do is to actually, act and make rulings on legal matters, and that judge should not necessarily be influenced by a certain belief system or pressure from a political party to rule in a particular way. We want that to be sort of sacred, that decision making. And I wondered, is it possible that we would also, in reverse, have a very too liberal situation where,
I totally get what you're saying.
I'm wondering about just human nature and what can we do to ensure that judges and the whole, being a judge remains impartial and remains distinct from our partisan politics.
It's really not meant to be a political position.
It shouldn't be.
Right? So, even talking about the elected judgeships that we had here in Pennsylvania and the folks that were up for retention votes, and they were up for retention votes and you didn't even know what party they belonged to.
Yes.
And that's the point of this, is that once someone's been on a bench for 10 years, you know their body of work. It shouldn't matter if they vote Republican or Democrat.
That's right.
Right? And so we've kind of gotten away from that when it comes to our federal appointments. It's supposed to be an independent check on the executive powers.
Yes.
And so right now what we're getting are nominees who are going to be, just straight rubber stamps for the current president.
Yeah.
And so we're getting away from this being a non-political process.
What concerns
to being very political.
Is that breakdown with a lifetime appointment and that breakdown over time.
Yeah.
Is this judge really going to be able to rule independently?
And what's concerning, to me, is that we've kind of gotten away from the way that we've always done things. Mm-hmm. For 100 years we had a blue slip process, and it worked for 100 years. And then it's gotten hyper-political, and now all of a sudden we have folks who want to do away with the blue slip process. Mm-hmm. It's just, we're going away from the typical things that we have done. If the Senate runs, if the Senate runs, it runs on tradition. Mm-hmm. It's all about the way the Senate is. It's a tradition. And we've gotten away from our tradition during this current administration for some reason.
Mm-hmm. One of the things that I found, I ended up doing a little exit polling on November 7th, and that was a wonderful opportunity to meet people here in Berks County. But I did run into a few people who came out kind of perplexed, because we in Pennsylvania, our precincts, had to vote on retention.
Yeah.
And, say, did I do the right thing? Did I vote? And that's the thing. I think it's so important to be informed before we walk into the polls about all of the questions that we're going to be asked.
Yeah.
And even things like retention, which you said, it's not a rubber stamp. Mm-hmm. We as voters can make a choice.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I'm going to ask another question. This one's kind of an open-ended question, but I think it might be good. I want you to really explain how courts are a line of defense against legislative and executive branches. I said that in the very beginning, and I believe that. But I'd love it if you could explain that a little bit more as a first line of defense and as a last line of defense.
Yeah. So our federal courts are going to be the last line of defense, particularly when you're in an administration that can be troubling for so many folks in the country. You talk about how they are a check and check and balances. Mm-hmm. They're a check on presidential power. And if we have so much going on in a presidency where we have travel bans that are mm-hmm. affecting Muslim, you know, majority Muslim yep. nations. If we have things going on with voting rights, mm-hmm. All of these issues are taken care of by the federal courts. A lot of us owe our rights in this nation, or the rights that have been taken away from us in this nation, to the federal courts. And they're going to be hearing cases coming up very shortly. There's the Masterpiece Bakery case that's coming up very soon in the Supreme Court that will be heard. That is about the bakery who decided not to bake a cake for a gay couple. Mm-hmm. And so that is going to the Supreme Court. If this is a religious reason, or, you know, it's going to be decided by the Constitution and mm-hmm. by our United mm-hmm. States Supreme Court, you know. And so it's all about, you know, maintaining our rights, our civil rights, mm-hmm. our voting rights, what kind of country we're going to be.
So when the court rules, when those courses, when those cases are actually heard, such as the bakery case,
yeah.
that really is the last line of defense. That's putting that amendment, yeah. is putting our Constitution to the task to, you know,
absolutely.
To rule.
Yeah. And, you know, the Supreme Court has heard so many cases in the last few years that pertain to, like, the ACA, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. the Affordable Care Act. They heard that case. They'll probably hear cases about mm-hmm. DACA. Mm-hmm. They'll hear cases about the unions. Mm-hmm. There's a Janus Supreme Court case coming up that is going to determine whether or not unions can, you know, be feasible, make money. Will they mm-hmm. have any political power at all, these unions? Will they be able to operate in states?
Explain that court, that case. Yeah. I don't know. Yeah. I haven't really heard much about that case.
It's Janus versus AFSCME.
Okay.
And so this is a case in which this is going to be decided by the newest Supreme Court justice, most likely,
okay.
Justice Gorsuch,
okay.
Because he'll have swayed the courts to the more conservative side. And so this is something that the union should be very fearful of. If you belong to a union, this is going to probably stop the way your union raises funds.
Hmm.
It would stop unions from having any political power because they won't have any money behind them.
Oh, no means to have...
To raise funds, yeah. So this is just, you know, an example of some of the things in the cases that our federal courts
that really does change a legacy of our workers' rights and our history of how we developed workers' rights.
You know, when I go around throughout the state and, you know, I go through the rooms and I talk to folks and I say, you know, what issues keep you up at night?
Mm-hmm.
Or what are you waking up to in the morning? And it's, you know, it's women's rights.
Mm-hmm.
You know, could we have a recall of Roe v. Wade,
mm-hmm.
you know, and this what's going on in the current climate? We talk to folks that are concerned about immigration and mm-hmm. health care, mm-hmm. education. These are all going to be heard in federal courts, these cases. If you're a mother or a father with an autistic child, there's a Supreme Court case, you know, mm-hmm. to that as well. Mm-hmm. There's the federal courts, you know, are there to help us or they can hurt us.
Yeah. And it's important that there be a constant connection between the Constitution and the judicial branch.
Yes.
I think that's what I hear you saying loud and clear.
Yes.
And I want to encourage our home viewers, we have a little bit more time, so if anyone is thinking of calling a question in, please do so. The number is 610-378-0426. Thank you. So, I wonder if we could go into, you had a couple slides, quotes that you wanted to talk about.
Yeah, with the red paint of the blue slip.
Yeah.
Let me see if I can get back to that.
Yeah. There we go.
Yeah. If we can show that one, that's great.
Mm-hmm. Maybe we can read it. So
yes.
We can
so people at home can.
And
so we were talking earlier about the blue slip process, and the blue slip is what provides our home state senators with the ability to provide some advice and consent when it comes to a judge sitting on a bench in their home state. And Senator Chuck Grassley, in 2015, the Senate Judiciary Committee chairman, said that he plans to honor it. You know, he appreciates the value of the blue slip, and he intends to honor it as his predecessor did. Patrick Leahy in Vermont used to be the Senate Judiciary Committee chairman. And this is another reason there are so many vacancies on the federal courts, is because Leahy, when it was his time, he honored the blue slip. The obstruction that came in, where people would not, you know, we had a lot of Republican senators who would not turn in their blue slip for qualified nominees, stopped this process, which has us to the point now where we have so many vacancies on the federal courts. And, you know, just to give a little context, in President Reagan's last 2 years in office, He was able to confirm more than 80 federal judges in his last 2 years. In Bill Clinton's last 2 years in office, he was able to confirm more than 70. In George W. Bush's last 2 years in office, he was able to confirm more than 60. You want to take a guess how many President Obama was able to fill in his last 2 years in office?
Not that many.
Not that many, 20.
And that was really because of the lack of cooperation, I think.
Lack of cooperation and obstruction in the last 2 years of his presidency.
Yeah. So I wanted to ask you about what we can do to advocate again. I want to go back to that. I think it's so important. I know, just as a League of Women Voter member, that voting is such an important right and privilege that we have. And being an informed voter is even more, is right up there, just as important as the voting itself, because you need to go into the booth knowing who you're going to vote for. Tell us how we can become more knowledgeable about who we're voting for when it comes, or when we get to the courts.
When you get to the courts, so both of us part of nonpartisan organizations, we're not going to tell you who to vote for,
right?
But we'll tell you some characteristics to look for when it comes to who you're going to select to be, either a lifetime appointment or
The characteristics. What
makes a good judge?
What makes a good judge?
Yeah. So number one, we want them to be qualified. They don't all have to attend Harvard. It's not necessary to attend Harvard or Princeton. There's some great judges that can come out of Temple University or, come out of Kutztown or here we are right now. So, it's about the quality. So you want to make sure, number one, they're qualified. That they've perhaps tried some cases in courts is always a great thing. That they have reasonable minds. We're not always going to agree on everything. When I got to have that conversation not too long ago with the current Third Circuit Court of Appeals judge, Ms. Marjorie Mandel, she talked to me about her relationship with Alito, who used to be on the Third Circuit Court of Appeals, and now he's a Supreme Court justice. And they didn't agree on everything, but she said that they both had reasonable minds, and they could come to different conclusions, but they came to that conclusion because they could argue that out, that they could, you could have a reasonable mind and figure out why you may not agree with something, why you may interpret something the way you do. And it has a lot to do with the fact of can you see things? Can you have a different perspective? For someone, who may never have lived paycheck to paycheck, you may not understand what it's like. And so it's so important that our judges, if they don't have that in their background, that they have the empathy and they have a reasonable mind
Maybe they've reached out and they've done some volunteer work, or they've done some church work, or something that you could say in their life has given them perspective.
We all have Facebook pages and all.
Yeah.
And so I encourage, go to this person's Facebook page, Google them. Lots of these folks are prolific bloggers. They've said lots of things over the last several years. And so do your research before you get behind that booth and pull the curtain and pull the trigger on the vote.
And what about the hearing process? I mean, what is it about that hearing process for a federal judge that we should be looking for when we watch a hearing?
Yeah. The hearings were so fascinating. If we go back to like Anita Hill and Clarence Thomas, we all paid attention to the hearings then, right? Yep. It was like One Life to Live or Better Than All My Children at the time. We've gotten to that point now where some of these hearings are starting to get very exciting. Justice Gorsuch's hearing was pretty exciting as well. And so we're looking to, we want for these hearings, we want to come out, what these people believe, what shapes their mind, will they be able to have a reasonable mind in their hearings. And then you have some folks right now who are going through their hearings and they're, we're finding more about them from their writings, but there's a nominee currently who thinks that transgender children or Satan's plan, part of Satan's plan, or we have some nominees who, are staunch advocates of executive powers, whose wives work in the White House. So there's some nominees right now that if you just do a little investigating and go back to their past work, you find out a lot about them.
And if you had a good candidate, I guess what you would be looking for, maybe some of the cases that they've taken on and how they came to the decisions that they made.
Yeah.
And I wish that we had more of that. I really do, because that seems to give us the balance that we need, the kind of perspective we need to make a decision.
Yeah.
So we've come very close to the end of our hour, and I want to say...
That went fast.
Yeah, went very fast. We went through many questions, but I think there's still so much more to learn, and I thank you all for tuning in. Again, this is the League of Women Voters Monthly Program. You can tune in every month to hear a program on some civic matter that we always want to cover for our readership or for our listenership. And I thank you again.
Yeah, and thank you know, I would love if, you know, if people have more questions about why yep. courts matter, or if they want to learn more about what we do in our organization, our Facebook is very mm-hmm. active. It's the Why Courts Matter PA Facebook page, or our website, which is whycourtsmatterpa.org. And learn more about what we do. Mm-hmm. We're out here working and fighting hard and advocating mm-hmm. for our federal courts.
Great. Thank you so much. Good night.
All right. Thank you. Thanks for having me.